Okay, welcome back to day 3 of this boot camp, which I've enjoyed tremendously so far. I hope that continues. So this is lecture 3 in the Arithmetic Applications of Pseudo-Randomness course. And given the title of the course, I thought I'd actually show you some pretty famous applications of pseudo-randomness in number theory before we get started. The first theorem is there to demonstrate that this actually, some of these techniques go back a really long time. So there is a very famous result of Vinogradov that says that every sufficiently large odd integer can be written as a sum of 3 primes. And obviously the it's closely related to the Goldbach problem. If you replace even odd by even and 3 by 2, then you've got a famous open problem for which these techniques are not sufficient. At least that's what we think. Another result that was mentioned yesterday in Jacob's lecture is Roth's theorem. So that states that any sufficiently dense subset of the integers 1 up to n, where you think of n as very large, contains a 3-term arithmetic progression. So again, this goes back more than half a century. But what sufficiently dense means is still the subject of intense scrutiny, and I'll say a few words about that later. Finally, a more recent result, 2003 is not the publication date, but the date I remember it being announced, so that the primes contain arbitrarily long arithmetic progressions, and we'll sort of see some steps towards that today, but also in Yusei's lecture tomorrow. Okay. I'll very briefly recall the definition of the Fourier transform that Fernando introduced in his first lecture. I won't be using it very much. I just want to point out that we work on this finite abelian group Fp to the n. I do need a p that's larger than 2 here, so in which case the Fourier transform, and there's already a mistake on the first slide, is actually defined to be the inner product of f with a character, which is of the form 2 to the e to the 2 pi I x t over p, so there's p roots of unity here. And you have an inversion formula because these characters form an orthonormal basis, and all these other properties, including the fact that the Fourier transform diagonalizes the convolution operator. And what I want to point out here is just that the way the convolution is defined and the fact that it behaves well under the Fourier transform is the main reason that we can use the Fourier transform to study these additive properties of integers or primes.
So I suppose 5 is equal to p here?
Yes, and the top slide I already, yes. The main reason the slide about the Fourier transform was there was to recall our first and most basic notion of pseudorandomness, which was defined in terms of the Fourier transform. So we say a set is uniform or pseudo-random its Fourier coefficients, its non-trivial Fourier coefficients, that's what I mean by its Fourier coefficients, are actually the Fourier coefficients of the characteristic function of the set. And I'm only looking at the non-trivial ones, as in the ones that are not at zero, because the Fourier coefficient at zero is always equal to the density of the set in the group. And Fernando showed us that this was more or less equivalent, at least quantitatively, to saying that A is uniform or pseudo-random if the set is small in the U2 norm. So the set, so it's not exactly the indicator function, but it's what we call the balance function of the set. So it's the centered version of the indicator function, right? Where I'm subtracting the density, which leads to the trivial coefficient being zero, which means that I can then talk about the L infinity norm of the Fourier transform of that function, which Fernando showed us was more or less equivalent to the U2 norm. Okay. What we got to at the very end of Fernando's lecture yesterday, which is actually a very fundamental part, was the question of why this notion of U2 uniformity is actually useful when you're studying certain types of arithmetic patterns. So I want to state the proposition that was very briefly on the board yesterday in some guise, which is the following. So if I have a function, so all my functions are going to be one bounded, so it maps from F3 to the n into minus 1, 1, and I'm interested in studying an arithmetic pattern such as a three-term arithmetic progression. So I might want to look at f of x plus d, f of x plus 2d. Then that average is bounded above by the U2 norm. And since I really consider this very fundamental, I will prove this for you briefly. It is actually very easy, and you don't really need any Fourier analysis for it. It just takes one line. So here is my average. The expectation xd of f of x plus d, f of x plus 2d. I'm going to reparameterize this and write u for x plus d. So I'm going to take an average over x and u, which will be f of x, f of u, f of 2u minus x. After reparameterization, and I'm going to look at the square of this quantity, and I will isolate the u variable and apply Cauchy-Schwarz, and what I get is an upper bound of the expectation in u of the square of the expectation of f of x 2u minus x. And I claim I'm essentially already done, because now I'll expand out the square. So I'll write the expectation in u and an expectation in x and y. So this is f of x, f of 2u minus x, f of y, f of 2u minus y. And just in case, if my function were complex valued, I would actually place conjugacy bars here, which would help me identify the appropriate change of variable to recover the U2 norm. So I want this to go to x plus a, this would go to x plus b, and adding up these two gives me 2x plus a plus b, so that tells me that 2u minus x is actually x plus a plus b, which is the fourth vertex of my U2 norm definition, which I'll just write up again very briefly up here. So you can compare. Okay. So really this is just one application of Cauchy-Schwarz, and you'll notice I've actually proved something slightly stronger than what's on the slide. But that's because really what I should be looking at here is an off-diagonal version of this statement, which you can also prove in pretty much the same way, but for which you need one more application of Cauchy-Schwarz. So the case where I have three different functions, f1 of x, f2 of x, x plus d, f3 of x plus 2d, and that you can bound by the minimum of the U2 norm of any of these three functions. So this tells you that if your function is uniform or small in the U2 norm, then it is negligible as far as counting three-term arithmetic progressions is concerned. So that is the fundamental proposition. It's very easy to prove, as you've just seen, but it is extremely important. Now, what does this actually tell me about configurations in sets? So how many progressions there are in subsets, say, of f3 to the n. Now, if I do set f equal to the indicator function of the set minus the density, then actually what we see is that this average here is just a number of three-term progressions in A minus alpha cubed. Okay, so that tells me if the U2 norm of the balanced function is small, then my set will contain roughly alpha cubed times the size of the group squared, many three-term progressions. And the upshot of that is that if my set is uniform or pseudo-random in the sense of the Fourier transform, then it contains the, I say, the expected number of three-term arithmetic progressions. That's a number of three-term progressions I'd expect in a random set of density alpha.
Okay. And that justifies using the word pseudo-random for this property of having small Fourier coefficients or small U2 norm, because it basically tells us that these uniform pseudo-random sets behave like random sets when it comes to counting three-term arithmetic progressions. Good. This is already enough to prove something like Roth's theorem, of which we already saw a proof yesterday in Jacob's course, using triangle removal. So the statement in F3 to the n, which is also known as the cap set problem, is the following. So if your set contains no non-trivial three-term arithmetic progressions, then it can't be too large. And here, we actually, using the Fourier transform, can derive a very good bound on what not too large. So notice that this tends to zero as little n tends to infinity. And I'll, again, just for later purposes, I'll give you a very quick sketch of the proof, and it just relies on the previous slide and the statement that we proved about uniform sets. So here it goes. So suppose your set were uniform. That the three-term progression doesn't have common difference zero. So where the three points are actually the same. So suppose your set is uniform in the Fourier sense or in the U2 sense, then actually the proposition on the previous slide showed that it contains loads of three-term arithmetic progressions, namely as many as you'd get in a random set. So given that our set contains no non-trivial three-term progressions, clearly our set can't be uniform. And just by definition, that actually means that the indicator function of the set has a large Fourier coefficient. So I'll try and remind you briefly what that means. So 1 sub a hat of t in F3 to the n was the expectation of 1 sub a of x e to the 2 pi I x dot t divided by 3. Okay. So if this average is large, that means that somehow we're going to have to hit one of the three possible values of this complex phase more often than the two others, right? With elements in the set A. So that essentially tells you that A is biased towards one of the three cosets of the subspace x dot t equals zero. And it tells you that this set basically has increased density on such a subspace, which has codimension one, and for all intents and purposes looks exactly like my original space. We've just lost one dimension. So I just concentrate on the set on that subspace, and I repeat the argument. It still has no three-term progressions, and I carry on. I lose one codimension at each step, but I also gain a certain amount of density on the subspace, and at some point these two bounds trade off against each other, and we get the bound above. Now, I said this was quite good, 3 to the n divided by n. It is quite good if you look at the corresponding problem in the integers, where we do not yet have a bound of this strength. But the lower bounds were much, much smaller. And in a big breakthrough in May of last year, Ellenberg and Kaiswright proved, based on an idea of Krutlev and Pach from just a few weeks beforehand, that actually a subset of F3 to the n containing no three APs has size at most 2.756 to the n, which up to this constant, which is obviously important, almost matches the lower bound. And Tom Bloom will tell us about the techniques that go into this proof tomorrow. The reason we've included it in the course is because the techniques are fundamentally completely different from anything that's gone before, and they're actually not based on Fourier pseudo-randomness. So we hope that this will be interesting.
Okay,
so there's a big open problem already. So, of course, we want to match the two bounds in F3 to the n. But more generally, we'd also like to know what the answer to this question is in the integers, which is generally a little bit harder.
Again, because Jacob mentioned it already yesterday, that there is a construction in the integers, which is due to Berend, that's from 1946, which shows that there are sets containing no three-term progressions in 1 up to n, and that are essentially of density e to the minus c square root n, log n. And the upper bound, the best known upper bound to date is the one on the right-hand side, so it's almost n over log n, and that's due to Tom Bloom. And I think we'll hear a lot more about this later on in the semester. Okay. Now, really what my lecture is supposed to be about is why this is not the end of the story of uniformity. It turns out that this notion of uniformity based on the Fourier transform and the U2 norm is no longer sufficient for counting other types of arithmetic patterns. And what I mean by that is not just that we haven't worked out how to make it work, but that there is a fundamental obstruction to using the Fourier transform. So in particular, the proposition I proved, well, essentially, the consequence of this one here, namely that a uniform subset contains precisely the same number of three-term progressions as a random set, is no longer true. What I'm going to show you is that there exists a set, and not just one, I mean, you can write down many, which is uniform in this Fourier sense, but it's not uniform with respect to counting four-term arithmetic progression. So it does not look like a random set in terms of its four-term progression count. So if I want to look at four-term arithmetic progressions or other types of pattern, I'd better make my group a bit larger, so F3 to the n doesn't really accommodate four terms in arithmetic progression. So I'm going to show you a set in F5 to the n. Unfortunately, this is really easy to write down. So here we go. I take all the elements of F5 to the n, whose inner product with himself is zero. Now, I claim that this set has two properties, namely that it is uniform as far as its Fourier transform is concerned, and B, that it does not contain the same number of four-term arithmetic progressions as a random set of the same density. So that means I should first of all figure out how many elements are in this set. So I claim the density is 1/5. So one way to work this out is you can actually, and this is a very neat trick, write the indicator function of this particular set as the average, so the expectation over U and F5, not F5 to the n. So I'll use e to the 2 pi I U times x dot x divided by 5. So I claim this is the indicator function for this set. Why is this the case? Because when I take the sum over all u in F5, then that's 0 unless x dot x is equal to 0, in which case function equals 1. So that's exactly the indicator function. And what's convenient about that is that I can just take the expectation of this, and I can pull the expectation of x through, and then I just have a very standard Gauss sum, which again, so this exponential sum is 0 unless u is 0, which is the case 1/5 of the time. So that tells me that this set has density 1/5. It also allows me to explicitly compute the Fourier transform of this set. So again, I can just write down what the Fourier transform ought to be. So this is e to the 2 pi I x dot t over 5. And I just plug in this value. And again, I have a standard Gauss sum. So the only large Fourier coefficient is actually at 0. And everywhere else, I have square root decay. So you can easily repeat these computations or look them up somewhere. So this set has small Fourier coefficients everywhere except at 0. So the more difficult part will be to convince you that this does not contain the same number of four-term arithmetic progressions as a random set.
So once I show you how to reason, it's not actually hard, but it may not be entirely obvious. So it's based on the identity, which I'll put on the screen rather than write it down, which is holds for all x and d. So it's x squared minus 3x plus d squared plus 3x plus 2d squared minus x plus 3d squared is equal to 0. If you like, you can expand this out. It's true. So why does this tell me that there are actually too many four-term progressions in this set? So imagine that I know that the first three terms of my arithmetic progression are in the set A. So what does that mean? It means that x dot x is equal to 0, x plus d dot x plus d is equal to 0, and x plus 2d dot x plus 2d is equal to 0. Now, by this identity, it also automatically implies that x plus 3d dot x plus 3d is equal to 0. Which tells me that once the first three terms in the progression are in my set, the fourth term will automatically lie in the set. Now, given that this set is uniform in the Fourier sense, we know that it has exactly as many three-term progressions as a random set, but every single one of these three-term progressions extends to a four-term progression. So actually this has alpha to the 3 times the size of the group squared, many four-term progressions, when a random set has alpha to the 4. Okay. So this means that the entire premise that our previous proof of Roth's theorem was based on is destroyed. And it turns out, I'm not going to say anything about that, that this is actually the only sort of equations of this type, relations of this type, are actually the only obstructions to using the Fourier transform for counting atoms. So that's a result of Tim Gowers and myself. Good. Now, we can still get around that. In fact, we can still, in a way not dissimilar to the way we proved Roth's theorem, prove Semiradi's theorem, which is the extension of, yes? Yes, it's actually easier for, yes, you can. You have to look at cubic relationships for 5 APs, and we'll see the reason for that later on. So the generalization of Roth's theorem, which is Semiradi's theorem, let's say in F5 to the N, would be to show that if you contain no four-term arithmetic progressions, then you have vanishingly small density. And there are a number of...
Can you use at most 5 or less? in
F5? Yes, so I guess I wanted to make the statement for four-term progressions. Let's stick with 4 for the time being. I'll say something about longer progressions later. I claim there are at least 5 different proofs that is Semiradi's original combinatorial proof. There was an ergodic theoretic proof by Furstenberg, which has spawned a lot of important developments in ergodic theory. The approach we'll be following is the one due to Gowers, which is based on what's called higher order Fourier analysis, which I'll explain. And there are close analogies between that and sort of hypergraph regularity approaches that, I don't know, Jacob will probably not mention. But there are generalizations of Semiradi's regularity lemma to hypergraphs. Good. Oh, and there is a lot of work that sort of tries to combine some of these approaches and is more qualitative using ultralimits. I'll say a few words about that at the end too. Now, the techniques that I'm about to explain to you have had a lot of other applications, in particular in theoretical computer science. So some of these things have been used in property testing, error-correcting codes, communication complexity, look at certain types of pseudo-random generators, and PCPs. I won't say much more about that, because I want to talk about the mathematical ideas. So how do we go about generalizing some of what we saw at the beginning to deal with this issue that... Yes.
Just real quick, is What's the language they would use when talking about this? They're not saying higher order Fourier analysis.
They would, yes.
Okay.
In certain instances, yes. And I'll give you some references at the end. There's a very extensive survey that you can look at for the CS applications. So fortunately, Fernando's already paved the way for me because he did introduce the U2 norm. And the reason that the U2 norm is called the U2 norm is because there's obviously also a U3 norm and a U4 norm and a U5 norm, etc. Okay, so I'll just briefly recall what the definition was. So it was just a sum over the vertices of this, what we call additive quadruple, which Fernando also explained you might want to visualize as the vertices of this parallelogram. So x, x plus a, x plus b, x plus a plus b. The compact way of writing this is by using this differencing operator, delta sub h of f at x is f of x times f of x plus h bar. Now you should think of this as a sort of derivative operator, but it acts in the exponent of your complex exponential phase. So we'll come back to that point as well. And we already saw the definition of the U3 norm, which is essentially you take this parallelogram, you extend it by an additional dimension. This is not a good pen. So you add an x plus c in your third dimension, and you draw the corresponding parallelepiped. So you get to a threefold average, or you could define it inductively as the average of all the U2 norms of the derivatives of f. And once I've written it like this, it's not hard to see that you can do this arbitrarily many times, and you get to averages over k-dimensional parallelepipeds. Now, it's also not hard to see that these UK norms are nested, so the U2 norm is less than or equal to the U3 norm, less than or equal to the U4 norm, and all of them are bounded above by the L infinity norm. They are actually bounded above by smaller LP norms, but I don't actually know of any good applications of this fact. Okay, now once you've got this sequence of nested norms, you can try and generalize the proposition we had in the beginning about how the U2 norm controls the count of certain types of arithmetic patterns. And indeed, this is not too difficult, so you can show that the four-term progression count in a set or a function f, more generally, is controlled by the U3 norm of the function. Now, the proof of this statement is exactly the same as this one here. You just need one more application of Cauchy-Schwarz. So you can generalize this to higher order UK norms and make your arithmetic progression longer. The proof of this statement is not difficult, but it took significant insight to observe that this was true. So with hindsight, it's very obvious. So there's nothing deep in here, but I think the observation was extremely non-trivial. Okay, so again, if I were to replace my function f by the balance function of a set, so one, the indicator function minus the density, what I'd get to after a little bit of computation would be that this average counts the number of four-term progressions in my set minus alpha to the 4, which would be the number of four-term progressions or the frequency of four-term progressions in a random set of that density. So that means that the U3 norm of the balance function measures the deviation from the random behavior as far as four-term progressions are concerned. I think, yes. So in particular, if my balance function has small U3 norm, then my set contains approximately the number of four-term progressions that a random set contains, and I'll call such a function quadratically uniform or quadratically pseudo-random.
Okay. You notice that it's much harder. So the U2 norm was less than or equal to the U3 norm. So it's harder for a function to be quadratically uniform than it is for it to be uniform. Okay. This is a stronger pseudo-randomness condition. Okay. Now, if we wanted to prove Semiradi's theorem, so a generalization of Roth's theorem, using this kind of iterative approach that I described earlier, we need to answer the question of what it means for a function to have large U3 norm. Remember, our iterative proof of Roth's theorem was based on this dichotomy, so either my set is uniform in the U2 sense, or it has a large Fourier coefficient, so it's non-uniform, and I derive some structural information from that. So here I would say either my set is uniform in the U3 sense, so it's quadratically uniform, or something else happens that hopefully I can use. So I'll just repeat what Fernando said about the U2 norm, which was literally just based on the fact that the U2 norm and the L-infinity norm of the Fourier transform are somewhat equivalent. So this is the inverse theorem for the U2 norm. If my function has U2 norm at least delta, then I'll sort of rephrase this as saying that there exists a linear phase function phi such that f correlates with it and has correlation at least delta squared. What do I mean by a linear phase function? I mean a function of the form e to the 2 pi I x dot t divided by phi, so an exponential function that is linear in x. And if you plug that into this average, you see that this is precisely what we mean by having this is precisely the definition of the Fourier transform. So all I'm saying is that this function has a large Fourier coefficient. Right? So this is just, it's easy because it's essentially straight from the definition. But it gives you some sort of idea, especially with the way that I phrase it now, that, and if you remember what our obstruction to using the Fourier transform was, namely that there's some sort of quadratic structure in the setup, what we might be looking for as an answer to the question, what does it mean for a function to have large U3 norm? Actually, one thing that's not too hard to prove is what it means for the U3 norm to be really large. So if the U3 norm is actually equal to 1, which is the maximum it can be for one bounded function, it's actually not hard to see that the function f essentially has to be a complex exponential involving a quadratic. The same way that the U2 norm being equal to 1 means that U essentially has to be the carrier. So now this is a deep result, which is, as I've stated it, due to Green and Tao, because they worked out the finite field model version of some of the ideas that were implicit in Gauss's proof of Semiradi's theorem, which happened almost a decade before. So if you have a function, a one-bounded function with U3 norm at least delta, then it does correlate with something we'll call a quadratic phase function. So it has inner product at least C of delta with a function that is of the form e to the 2 pi I phi times Q of x, where Q of x is a quadratic form over F5 to the n. Now I'll say a little bit about the proof of this theorem as well as what the correlation actually is. So, of course, if you think about it, we said we defined the UK norms inductively, so and we said there is an inverse theorem for the U2 norm, which means that you correlate with a linear function. And so somehow it seems that you might want to use an inductive approach to use this theorem, and it's indeed what you try and do. I remember that the U3 norm of f to the power 8 was equal to the average of the fourth powers of these U2 norms of the derivative, right? So you know that when the U3 norm of the function is large,
that on average, all of the derivatives have large U2 norm.
Right?
That's just true by definition, essentially. On average, the derivatives of the function will have large U2 norm. Now, you know what it means for a function to have large U2 norm. Namely, you know that that means that it correlates with a linear phase. So we know that for many values of h in my group, delta sub h of f correlates with a linear phase. So you know that the derivative of the function essentially looks like a linear function in many places. So that sort of tells you that surely the function itself should look like a quadratic function, right, globally. Now, the problem with this is, and this is where the deep work happens in this theorem, that these linear phases, there's no reason why they should actually match up to give you this global quadratic correlation, right? So most of the work, and there's a lot of combinatorics in here, goes into actually gluing these different linear things together in a way that you get this global quadratic correlation. So I think even the quickest proof of this theorem probably would still take if we'd prepared all the combinatorics that goes into it, it would probably still take 3 lectures to do in detail. So we're not going to do it. And one more thing I should say that when p equals 2, which is a special case that wasn't covered by Green and Tao, this was actually worked out by Sasha Samarodnitsky. So he was interested in quadratic property testing, and I'll say a little bit more about that. Now, here is a big open problem, which is improving the correlation in this theorem. So how large is this correlation? So it's conjectured that the correlation is actually polynomial in delta, so the size of the U3 norm. And it's been shown by both Green and Tao and Shahar Lovett that this is actually equivalent to a very famous open problem in additive combinatorics, namely the polynomial Freiman-Ruge conjecture. That says something about the structure of sets whose sum set is bounded. So A plus A is just the combination of all little a and little a prime that are in A. So I'm looking at all possible sums. And if the set of the sums isn't too much larger than the set itself, what we'd like to say is that somehow this means that A is efficiently contained in a subspace. If you think about the extremal case, when you have a subspace and you take sums of itself, it doesn't expand at all. There are results of this type in particular. There are results of Freiman and Ruge, and more recent work of Sanders, which actually gives the best current bound on this. So it's essentially sub-exponential quasi-polynomial. So I've written it like this because eventually I expect this to become a constant. So we're sort of not so far away from this, but so the Freiman-Ruge theorem is used in the proof, so it's part of this combinatorial ingredients that I alluded to earlier. So it's not so hard to see that polynomial bounds for this conjecture would give polynomial bounds on U3, and then the reverse direction is a little more interesting. there's another obvious question you can ask. Well, I mean, we already said that, you know, we've set up this entire sequence of UK norms. I said that this proposition about how the UK norm controls the count of k plus one term arithmetic progressions generalizes as well. You just need one additional application of Cauchy-Schwarz. So what can you say about functions with large U4 norm, U5 norm, U6 norm, etc.? Now, we do have a statement that says, for example, if my function on f5 to the n, one bounded function, has large U4 norm, then it correlates with, well, I guess, what's a cubic phase function? I'm not going to define that. But the problem with this is that this currently this correlation C of delta is entirely qualitative. So this is based on work of Bergels and Green, Tau and Ziegler and various combinations. They used ergodic theoretic methods, so they proved this in an infinitary statement and used a correspondence principle to pull that information back to F5 to the n. I think what's worth noting about this is that this is really an entirely combinatorial statement in the sense that, you know, that the U4 norm tells you that you have a certain count of four-dimensional parallelepipeds. You're saying that means my function should correlate with a cubic phase function, which again is completely explicit. So there should be a proof of this that doesn't require you to use all this ergodic theoretic machinery and that actually spits out some bounds. And I think this would have a lot of implications in computer science as well. Okay. It turns out that things are a little bit worse, even in this finite field model, than I've just made you believe. So what I've stated here is actually true, that if you have a function in F5 to the n with large U4 norm, then it does actually correlate with a cubic phase. But you have to be a little bit careful. So at this point, we have to start caring about how large the prime p is. So it turns out that there are issues in small characteristic. So if the degree of your polynomial is at least as big as a characteristic, then you're going to run into trouble. And there was a very explicit example that was given by Lovett, Meshulam, and Samarinitsky, and also by Green and Tau, which for a while made people worry that a U4 inverse theorem might actually be false. So if you look at the quartic symmetric polynomial on F2 to the n, and you look at the function f of x defined as being minus 1 to that polynomial, so that actually has massively large U4 norm. It turns out you can compute it. But it does not correlate with any cubic polynomial. Now, that sounds like it's a huge problem. But it turns out it has been fixed in the meantime. And the way to resolve this issue is to reconsider what it means to be a cubic phase function. Right? So I basically said at the start, in fact, I didn't say anything. I said a quadratic phase function was something of the form e to the 2 pi I from now on, let me write omega as e to the 2 pi I over p. So my p's root of unity, right? That makes it a little easier. So I said a quadratic phase function was a function of the form omega to the q for some quadratic polynomial q, or quadratic form q. But I'm already assuming here that any polynomial phase function will essentially take a p-th root of unity here. It turns out that if you really look at a phase polynomial as of degree k as being the function f whose kth derivative is equal to 0, the kth multiplicative derivative is equal to 0, you actually get a wider class of phase functions in small characteristic. So in particular, it turns out that this function actually does correlate with not just a cubic, but even a linear polynomial, but one that sits on an eighth root of unity. So you need to look at a slightly wider class of phase functions, which are now known as non-classical phase polynomials. But I'll leave you to explore that in the references. OK. I think we're almost on time. Yes. Now, why am I talking about higher order Fourier analysis? And in particular, what I want to talk a little bit about is quadratic Fourier analysis. What gives me the right to say that there is anything resembling Fourier analysis in all of the ideas that I've just described? So for that, to justify that, I want to go back to the things that Fernando talked about. So he summed up this dichotomy between either my set is uniform or it has some structure in a decomposition
of the form F
equals F1 plus F2, where F1 has some linear structure with bounded complexity, and F2 is small, either in the Fourier or the U2 sense. So let me write that down. So in particular, he showed you this decomposition theorem, or what he called a weak regularity theorem, a weak regularity lemma, in which F1 was equal to the projection of F onto some linear factor, and F2 was a function that was that had small U2 norm. And this factor had bounded complexity in the sense that there weren't too many linear phases involved in defining this factor. And then he had the more advanced version, the strong regularity lemma, where you actually have a trade-off between how uniform pseudo-random this part is and how what the complexity of the other part is, which you do need in almost all of the applications. Now, really, many of you will be much more familiar with decompositions of this type if I'd written it just straightforwardly in terms of the Fourier transform. So I will recall the inversion formula here. I don't even know what group I'm in, but let's see. Let me write omega for whatever pth root of unity I need, minus x dot t. Okay. Now, something that's familiar to, I'm sure, almost everyone here is that when I write my function like this, I can often approximate this function just by looking at the large Fourier coefficients of this function, right? So what I could have done is I could have, say, R is a set of t such that f hat of t is large. Let's say it's at least epsilon. And I just look at the part with the large Fourier coefficients plus the part with the small Fourier coefficients. And this here would be my structured part, linearly structured part. It has bounded complexity because a function with, let's say, bounded L2 norm can't have too many large Fourier coefficients. This one has small U2 norm, essentially because I've, by definition, made the Fourier coefficient small. Okay. And why is this really easy to do, and I don't need any sort of energy increment strategy or anything like that? It's because the characters here form an orthonormal basis, right? So I have the inversion formula. I can just split it in two. And you can prove regularity versions in this Fourier world as well, where you have a strong separation between how uniform this part is and how complex this part is.
This doesn't quite give you what you wanted because the first the function, the simple function, isn't necessarily bounded, right?
Yes, and that's a problem that we're going to come back to in the quadratic approach that I'm about to show you. I don't actually need it to be bounded. I need some bound on it. Yes, so I don't need it to be one bounded. Yeah, sorry, that didn't. So I don't need it to be in zero, map into 0, 1, but I do need something, yes. Okay, so in my, if I now wanted to impose a stronger pseudo-randomness condition on the pseudo-random part, which I'm interested in because I showed you if my part of my function, for example, is small in U3, then I can neglect it for the purpose of counting four-term progression, then I'd like to write F as F1 plus F2. Where F2 is, let's say, quadratically uniform, and F1, well, correspondingly, has some sort of quadratic structure, because we saw in the inverse theorem for the U3 norm that if you're, if the function is not quadratically uniform, and it has large U3 norm, then it has some quadratic structure. It has some correlation with some quadratic phase, and that structure is going to go into the structured part of my decomposition. Now, the reason that's not straightforward at all is because these quadratic phase functions do not form an orthonormal basis of my spaces functions. So I have to do something else. So one thing that's been done, and this should look very familiar to you, so is a decomposition of the following type, and this is due to Green and Tao. So I can write my function as f1 plus f2, where f2 has small u3 norm, let's say at most delta, and f1 is a projection of f onto a factor, except this time it's quadratic in nature, by which I mean that it's a partition of fp to the n into sort of simultaneous level sets of quadratic forms, rather than the linear parts that Fernando talked about. And as Russell just pointed out, the advantage of that is that this is very nicely bounded, because it's a projection. And I have a trade-off between how complex this quadratic part is and how uniform my u3 part is. Now, the way you prove this is exactly the same. It's exactly the same proof that Fernando showed us. You feed in the information from the u3 inverse theorem as opposed to the u2 inverse theorem, and you use this energy increment strategy. So I'm not going to do this. What I did want to show you is a decomposition that looks a little more like the classical Fourier decomposition. And I want to do this for two reasons that are nothing to do with the fact that my name is on that result. So the two reasons are because I think it will look more intuitive to some people, because you're more used to seeing things decomposed into Fourier coefficients, and because the technique that's used to prove it is not the L2 energy increment argument. It's the finite dimensional Hahn-Banach theorem, and it's a technique that's also been applied in other contexts, both in computer science and in number theory. In particular, maybe Yufei will briefly allude to that tomorrow. I don't think he will actually prove it. But it was also important in proving the transference principle, which then allows you to prove the Green Tower theorem in the primes, which is a dense set. There's not a dense set, so a lot of these methods don't apply directly. Okay, so here is a statement I want to prove. And that will be the end of my talk. So I take my function f, i5 to the n. I don't require it to be one bounded. There's a slight difference here. I require its L2 norm to be at most one. Again, I don't know any applications of the fact, but you'll see in the proof why this is the natural condition that pops out. So then I claim that I can decompose my function into the following sum. So it's a sum of quadratic phase polynomials with some coefficients, plus a function g, plus a function h. These qj's are quadratic forms, and they're 5 to the n. So this is my quadratically structured part, f1. I have g small in u3, and h small in the L1 norm. So this is an error that also popped up in Fernando's regularity lemma yesterday. Again, you'll see why it's there. It's important. It needs to be there for this particular group. And crucially, the complexity of this structured part is bounded in the sense that the sum of, so the L1 norm of the coefficients of these quadratic forms is at most m, where m depends on the error parameters I have here, in a way that's essentially entirely dependent on what comes out of the inverse theorem. Okay. Yes? No, not from this proof technique. You'll see why. I don't know. I did want to make one more remark there are other ways of proving statements of this kind. So I have a paper with Mario Torsiani where we use a boosting technique, so that might be of interest to some machine learning people. And you can, there are various types of gradient descent you can use. Okay, so when I say the Hahn-Banach theorem, I really mean the separating hyperplane theorem, and this is going to be a finite dimensional normed space. So if I have a vector of norm at least one, then I can find a vector with which it has inner product at least one, and such that all vectors inside the unit ball have inner product at most one. Okay. Vector Z separates outside the unit ball from inside. In fact, I will want to refer to this condition here, that the inner product of y with z is at most 1 for all y of norm at most 1, as actually saying that the dual norm of z is at most 1. Okay, so this will be easier. Now I'm going to show you a very horrible looking corollary, and I really mean it's horrible. But it really is a direct consequence of this theorem if you write down the right norm. So because I'm interested in decomposing my function into various bits, I assume that my function is a sum of subspaces of C to the N, each with its own norm. And I'm going to choose the norms later. And I'm going to suppose that it's not possible to write sum vector x, when the function I might be interested in, as a sum x1 plus x2 plus dot 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 plus xk in such a way that xi lives in vi and such that the sum of the norms with the coefficients alpha is at most 1. And what you can conclude from that is that there exists a vector z which has inner product at least 1 with x, and such that the inner product of z with each y of norm at most 1 in the space vi is at most alpha I. And when I say it's a direct consequence, I really mean all you need to do is convince yourself that you can define a norm on the space Cn, so to be the infimum of all of these combinations, alpha 1 x 1 1, alpha k x k k, such that x can be represented as x 1 plus dot 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 plus x k, with each x I being in vi. And you need to convince yourself that the dual norm of this is z star, which is the maximum of alpha I inverse Z I star for each individual one. And this really just pops out. Now what I want to show you, I'm going to take 2 minutes to do this, maybe three. But then once you have this corollary, you can prove the decomposition theorem that I had on the previous slide, or at least a simple version of it. And I'll remind you what we were trying to prove. So we're going to do this by contradiction. So suppose I cannot write my function f as sum of the lambda i's omega to the qi plus g plus h, where the sum of the absolute values of the coefficients is at most m, the U3 norm of g is at most delta, and let's for simplicity also just require that the L1 norm of h is at most delta. Okay, so what are my subspaces going to be? I clearly have one subspace that's just C to the n, where the capital N is F5 to the n. With the L1 norm, I have one subspace that's C to the n with the U3 norm. Then for every quadratic phase, for every possible quadratic form that you can imagine, I'm going to take the subspace, a one-dimensional subspace that just consists of scalar multiples of that quadratic form, and the norm of that subspace is going to be the size of the coefficient. So with the other third norm, if you like. Suppose I can't do this. Now, when I say I can't do this, I could have written these conditions slightly differently, namely M inverse sum of the lambda i's plus delta inverse U3 norm of G plus delta inverse L1 norm
of H.
So that tells me what my alpha i's are. And what I'm getting from the statement is, so Hahn-Banach tells me that there exists a vector z, which I'm going to call phi, because it's going to be a phase function, such that the inner product of f with phi is at least 1. And what else? There's a few more things, namely that the dual norm of phi with respect to this space, so U3 is at most, U3 star is at most delta inverse. It tells me that the dual norm with respect to the L1 norm, so that's just L infinity, is at most delta inverse. And it tells me that the inner product of phi with any quadratic phase is at most M inverse, so this is for all Q. This just pops out of the statement, and I'll show you in two more lines how to conclude the proof. So I have a lot of information here. The first bit of information I have is that the inner product of F with phi is at least 1, which I can apply Cauchy-Schwarz to. So by assumption, and this is where the L2 norm assumption comes in on F, this is at most 1. So that actually tells me that the L2 norm of phi is at least 1. Now, why is that good? Because again, I can apply, not quite Cauchy-Schwarz, but the definition of the dual norm. So the inner product of phi with phi is bounded above by the U3 norm of phi times the U3 star norm of phi. Okay. Now, over there, I said that the U3 star norm of phi was at most delta inverse, which, to my great joy, tells me that the U3 norm of phi is at least delta. Now, this looks like we're ready to apply the U3 inverse theorem and conclude that phi correlates with a quadratic phase, but it can't correlate very much, namely by at most an amount M inverse. Yes, so then that gives you a bound on how big M has to be. Now, the one drawback, and this is where your L1 error comes from, and that maybe answers your question, is that I can only apply the U3 inverse theorem to one bounded functions. And my function phi, there's no reason why it should be one bounded. But what I do know is that it's bounded by delta inverse. That's why I needed the L1 norm in my decomposition to make this function bounded by something. So I can rescale it by delta. And then do what I just said, namely, so U3 inverse tells you that some version of phi, so the rescaled version, has inner product with some q of size at least c of delta squared. And that has to be less than okay, good. I guess what I did want to say is that there are lots of problems that you're probably not interested in about where these objects come from on the integers. There's a lot of work that's gone on over the past 5 years in that direction. And I've created a reading list for you. I would suggest the lecture notes of Ben Green for this, which are really excellent. And I have written a survey on the more recent developments
That you may wish to consult parts of.
And the third reference is an extensive survey on applications of higher order Fourier analysis with a view to computer science. Thank you very much for your attention. And I do take questions, even though I overran.
So for this problem of the quantitative inverse theorem for the
U4 node, yeah.
So, is it believed that if you have sufficient energy, you could sort of use the same sketch that you gave for the U3?
No, people have tried. I have tried quite hard. No, I think there's generally something we don't understand, and I think there's a new idea that's needed. You can't just... So what you can get is a weak sort of inverse theorem, but not something of the type. You can get some local correlations, but you can't get the full global correlation, at least as far as I'm aware.
Is the dependence also considered to be polynomial in high order?
I don't think anybody has dared to make such a conjecture, given that we currently have no bounds at all.
What role does your prime play? I mean, the prime was 5 most of the time.
Yes.
Can I pick 163 throughout your talk, or do you random prime?
So the only times I'd be concerned about you using a prime is if the prime was really small, like smaller than the degree of the polynomials that you'd be using for these decompositions, then you run into trouble. Okay. If you wanted to make your prime large, I don't see any issue with that. You get some dependence on how large the prime is.
But so the cubic stuff won't work with 2, so to speak.
Yeah. Okay. Actually, the quadratics, yes, the cubic stuff doesn't work with 2. Yes, that's right.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So with the Hahn-Banach stuff, this was the first place I had seen that we actually used that the uniformity norms are genuine norms. Is that useful elsewhere, or was this the first place that... It didn't seem so important before, just that it was controlled by other norms.
That is a very good question, and I will think about that and get back to you. I do think it's important that they're norms, and there is a genuine general question about whether these are literally the only norms that actually do this job for you. I mean, there are analogies in graphs. So David mentioned the Sidorenko conjecture, right, about sort of what sort of norms you can meaningfully define so they're actually useful to you. And there are questions of this type in this area as well. So You do use various so it's very important that it's a semi-norm, because there are various places where you use the triangle inequality, etc., for it. I'm not entirely sure about the rest. Okay, let's get on with tea and coffee, and if you have any other questions.